John 10, we're going to take it easy this week. Not really. This is actually a really wonderful text and a great way to kind of pause our time. John 10, starting in verse 22, the title of our lesson today is Jesus Telling the Truth. Is Jesus Telling the Truth? Last week, Tim took us through from verse 1 to 21, and today we're moving one verse into verse 22. Now, it's important that we talk about kind of what's going on here and important that we frame the text the right way. You see, from verse 21 to verse 22, there's actually a pretty big gap. There's a gap of 2 months that takes place from verse 21 to verse 22. And the reason I tell you that is because it's very important that when we study the Bible, we understand context. When I was studying the Bible, I had a teacher who constantly said, context, 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 context is king. Because oftentimes, if we don't understand the context of what is going on in the text, it'll be hard for us to see what is being said in the text, which is why context matters. And so today, we are moving 2 months in the future from where Tim left us last week in verse 21. And so let's see what happens starting in verse 22. Here's what it says. Then came the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts walking in Solomon's colonnade. Okay. So there's a lot of things here that we can look at to help build the scene, understand the set, and really understand the context. What do we see here? We see a few things. Number one, we see that Jesus is in the city of Jerusalem. We see that it's winter. And we see that the festival of dedication is taking place. If you were with us a few weeks back, I spent about 15 minutes going through roughly 400 years of Jewish history. And I dialed in specifically on the Maccabean Revolt. And if you weren't here for that time, I'll kind of give you a quick refresher. In 167 BC, the Seleucid Empire, led by a guy named Antiochus Epiphanes, attacked the city of Jerusalem, besieged the city of Jerusalem, took control of the city of Jerusalem, and basically desecrated the entire town of any kind of Jewish religion or symbolism. Remember, they were sacrificing pigs on the altar to Zeus, and they were making a mockery of everything Jewish. And this was causing a lot of problems. The Jewish people were not a fan of this. And so a time came with a priest by the name of Mattathias and his 5 sons led a rebellion against the Seleucids, and eventually they were able to take control of the city of Jerusalem, and they rededicated the temple to the God of Israel. Well, during this rededication, it was an 8-day festival, and so they spent 8 days rededicating God's temple back to God. Well, that's what's going on here. This is the festival of dedication, also known as Hanukkah, all right? We know that today, the Hanukkah, it happens oftentimes in the month of December, mid to late December. Well, this is what they're celebrating here. They're celebrating Jewish independence and the reality that the temple of God has been dedicated back to God. They're celebrating Hanukkah, okay? So that's what's happening here. But there's another detail I want us to see, and it's in verse 23. It says that Jesus was in the temple, specifically Solomon's colonnade. Now, here's a picture. I think I have a picture up here to help us kind of understand what's going on here. So Solomon's colonnade, or Solomon's portico, or Solomon's porch, it's called all of those different things, but you can kind of see it right over there, kind of on the entrance to the court of the Gentiles. If you're looking at this, you can kind of see that Solomon's porch is one of the only areas that is covered. It's one of the only areas where Gentiles and Jewish people could come together in one space and essentially rub shoulders. And so Solomon's porch, Solomon's portico, Solomon's colonnade, however you want to call it, became a de facto meeting spot for Gentiles and Jewish people to come together and talk. It was also a source of protection from rain or from wind. It was covered, and so it was a natural meeting spot. One commentary I read described Solomon's colonnade like this, quote, "Solomon's colonnade served as a melting pot of ideas and thoughts where the Gentiles and the Jewish people could all come and gather together." So this is like a meeting place. And so here's what's happening. Jesus is in this hallway, and the way I envision it is that rain is coming down, maybe the sky a bit overcast. Picture Sunday of last week. Picture Jewish people and Gentile people that are all religiously inclined, celebrating Hanukkah, gathered under Solomon's colonnade. Let's see what happens. Verse 24. The Jews who were gathered around him were saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. It's interesting. That word for gathered around literally means to encircle. It means to hem in the Greek. Now, as I was studying this week, when I was trying to just really envision this scene, for whatever reason, my mind kept going back to Lord of the Rings, when Gandalf was with the Fellowship, and he was, you know, in the mines of Moria, super nerd here, and they kind of like set off an alarm, and they get surrounded by all the goblins, and then there's Gandalf standing there in the dark with his light. That's, for whatever reason, what I envision here. I picture Jesus standing boldly, the light of the world, surrounded by these goblin Pharisees that are ticked off, okay? That's what I envision. It's fun to think this way about scripture. It breathes a little bit of life to it. And so this is what I picture. I don't know if you picture this, but it's fun too. And their question is very simple. The Pharisees are asking one question, and their question is this: is Jesus really the Messiah? That's their question. Is Jesus really the Messiah? Is Jesus really who he says he is? Is Jesus telling the truth? Let's see how he responds in verse 25. Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name, they testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep." We're going to talk about sheep in a bit. Verse 27, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one can snatch them out of my Father's hand." Verse 30, "I and the Father are one." Pretty cool response here. Jesus says a few things. I want to show you two of them. The first thing Jesus says in response to their question is this. Number one, "I have already told you that I'm the Messiah." That's what he says. He says, "I've already told you who I am." Now, I don't know about you, but if you've been with us through this study, through the book of John, we have seen Jesus say this how many times? Countless times, over and over and over again. The Pharisees are saying, "Are you really the guy?" And Jesus is like, "Yes, I am." "But really? Yes, I am." And so here in John 10, again, I like to envision Jesus just getting a little peeved here, you know? Like, what the heck is wrong with you blockheads, right? Like, how many times do I have to tell you this over and over again? And you and I can relate to this, right? Like, how annoying is it when we say something to someone that is true, but then they constantly respond with doubt? Like, but really? It's like, yeah. But really? Like, I don't have kids, but I hear parents talk about this all the time, right? I hear parents talk about this all the time. Like, hey, mommy, can I have a cookie at 7 o'clock right before bed? And, you know, the mom says no. And it's like, okay, child goes to sleep. Exactly 24 hours later, "Mommy, can I have a cookie right before bed?" "No." Like, what the heck is wrong with you? You got this from your dad's side, you psycho. You know what I mean? Like, I have a feeling that'll take place in our relationship. Natty will. Actually, it won't. I was actually thinking about this week, and I was thinking to myself, if I could write down like a chart of all the attributes that I would want our kids to have, there would be 99 from Maddie and like one for me, and it would be like my height or something like that. Like, you know, it would come from her father's side, my father. It would come from me, the dad. I would be the dad. So that's essentially what I'm getting at. But you guys know, it's so annoying when we say something over and over again. I just want to make that clear for us. Thank you. Hey, we're a family, we're good. When you say something over and over again, but for whatever reason, it falls on deaf ears. There's frustration. There's, oh, what the heck is wrong with you people? Now, some of you might be thinking, Austin, okay, let's be fair though. Let's be fair to the Pharisees. Did Jesus actually ever say that he was God? Did he ever actually clarify to the people about his deity? Did he ever say that? It's a good question. Let's look at it. In fact, let's do a little study here for about a minute, and I want to show you all of the times just in the book of John that we've already seen when Jesus claims to be God, when Jesus claims deity. So let's look at this. I think I have them on the screen. I believe I do. So what did Jesus say? Starting in John 3, Jesus said, "I am the one who came from heaven. He said, whoever believes in me has eternal life. He says, I am the unique Son of God. I will judge all humanity. All should honor me just as you honor God the Father. The Hebrew scriptures all speak of me. I perfectly reveal God the Father. I please God and never sin. I've been uniquely sent from God. Before Abraham was, I am. I am the Son of Man prophesied by Daniel. I will raise myself from the dead. I'm the bread of life. I'm the light of the world. I'm the door, and I am the good shepherd. So friends, just very basic. Has Jesus told the people who he is? One more time.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes. Yes. He has told them who he is. Without a shadow of a doubt, Jesus is crystal clear. He's claiming to be God. But Jesus doesn't stop there. He says, not only have I told you who I am, I've showed you who I am. This is number two. I have shown you who I am. Look at what he says. He says, the works I do in my Father's name testify about me. In other words, Jesus is like, hey, look at all the miracles I've done. Look at all the miracles I done. You see, you have to realize what's going on here. In this big group of people, remember, there's the religious elite, right? The Jewish leaders, the Gentile leaders. We're all surrounding Jesus, right? The goblin army around Gandalf. They're surrounding Jesus, and they knew who he was. They had heard, or some of them even had seen, the miracles that Jesus had done. They would have known all too well about the time that Jesus healed the man who was born blind, which happened just a few chapters earlier. They would have known all too well about the time that Jesus fed the thousands of people with a little kid's Happy Meal, right? With a few sardines and some bread. They would have been all too familiar with the time that Jesus walked across the water, calmed the storm, exercised authority over the winds and the waves, and then magically, supernaturally, transported his disciples to the other side of the Sea of Galilee completely safe. They would have known who Jesus was. At this moment in history, in this context, Jesus was not some fringe, sideshow, circus act. Jesus was a headline maker. They knew who he was. They had heard about the things he was doing. Jesus was a big deal. Yet the religious leaders of this time, they wanted absolutely nothing to do with it. They wanted nothing to do with it. And so let's see what happens in verse 31. Again, his Jewish opponents picked up stones to stone him. But Jesus said, I've shown you many good works from the Father. For which of these do you stone me? So just picture this. They're out, they're grabbing stones, they're angry, and Jesus is like, yo, why? Like, why are you grabbing these stones? And they say, we're not stoning you for any good work, they replied. But look at this. But for blasphemy, because you, a mere man, claim to be God. I love that. I love that concept of a mere man. They knew everything Jesus had done, and they still had the audacity and the ignorance to point at Jesus and say, mere man. So they're getting hostile. They grab the stones, and they want to kill him. Now, if you remember in the book of John, this is the second time that Jesus has been encircled with people loaded up with their ammo to destroy Jesus on the spot. The famous preacher Charles Spurgeon preached on this text, and he said this, quote, if they cannot answer holy arguments with fair reasoning, they can give hard answers with stones. If you cannot destroy the reasoning, you may perhaps destroy the reasoner. Friends, a surefire way of knowing when an argument has been won is when somebody resorts to name-calling or violence. That's when you know you're on the winning side. And that's what's taking place here in John chapter 10. They don't have a good answer, and so they said, you know what we're going to do? We're going to kill the reasoner. We're going to kill Jesus. But the story continues, verse 34. Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law, I have said you are gods? If he called them gods, to whom the word of God came, and scripture cannot be set aside, what about the one whom the Father set apart as his very own and sent into the world? Why then do you accuse me of blasphemy? Because I said, I am God's son. Do not believe me unless I do the works of my Father. But if I do them, even though you do not believe me, believe the works that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I in the Father. All right, moment of honesty, friends. How many of you, the last 20 seconds, and I just read that, don't know what was just said? Anybody? Come on, Thaddeus and my wife are the only honest people here. And Dan, thank you. Yeah, come on, we can be real. Did you understand it? Okay, good. Well, not good, but we'll explain it. I read this about 37 times this week, and I kept going, what in the world is going on? What is Jesus saying here? Because on the surface, it's kind of confusing. But I want to show you what's being said, because it's actually pretty cool. It's actually pretty unique. You see, essentially what Jesus is doing here is revealing their hypocrisy. He's revealing their hypocrisy, and he does this specifically by quoting scripture, specifically Psalm chapter 82. Here's what Psalm 82 verse 6 says. It said, I said that you are gods. You are all sons of the Most High. So that's what Jesus is quoting to the religious leaders at this moment. In Psalm 82, Asaph, the writer of the psalm, is talking about how God will judge the wicked. Specifically, how God will judge, listen to this is very important, will judge those who are in power, and specifically those who are in power who abuse people with their power. It's very important we see this, and we're going to be talking about this a lot in the Cross Culture series. It's very important to see, we have to remember this, that God is the one who raises up leaders and tears leaders down. That is accurate and clear all throughout Scripture. We see that OT and New T. Old Testament and New Testament. Daniel 2:21 and Romans 13:1. It's very clear. God raises leaders up and tears leaders down. Really, Austin? Yes. What about the leaders we have now? Take it up with God. That's what we see. And in Psalm 82, he writes, Asaph writes, you are gods. What does he mean by that? Well, he's talking about the people that are leaders of the day, specifically the rulers over the Jewish people. The prophets, the priests, the religious leaders who have been placed there by God to exercise authority over people which was given to them by God. And so Jesus is looking at this crowd of people and saying, you know judgment's coming for you. You know what's coming for you. And his argument is essentially this. He says, if God would call mere people gods, then why is it blasphemous for me, the true Son of God, to say that I'm equal with God? That's essentially the argument here. In other words, Jesus is saying, when was the last time you exercised power over the wind, buddy? He's saying, when was the last time you healed a man that was born blind? When was the last time? Give me a date. When was the last time you showed all people that you had power over the elements, change water into wine? Jesus is essentially saying, of all people, it would be you guys, the religious leaders, the PhD earners, the page turners, the scholastic thinkers. Of all people, you guys should see most clearly that I am who I say I am. Of all people, you guys should recognize that I am the Son of God, but you refuse to do so. That's what he's doing here. Now, I imagine that at this moment, this crowd who's already holding rocks gets even more angry. In fact, we don't even see them respond. It says in verse 39, again, they tried to seize him, but he escaped their grasp. I think this is a cool verse, and if we could spend more time on it, I would like to. But one little nugget about this verse that I find so fascinating. How did he escape their grasp? Like, think of it. It's Jesus surrounded by hundreds of people. And based on all accounts, we know that Jesus was not some 6'10" macho man, 275 pounds, who could dumbbell lift four regular-sized Jewish dudes. So how did Jesus escape? I don't know. Miraculously? Maybe? It's so funny to me that even when Jesus removes himself from this situation, he's proving to people that he is who he says he is. I love that. It's just the comedy. It's just the beauty. It's just, you gotta think of this kind of stuff when you read the Bible. Yeah, it's beautiful. I love it. It's so interesting. But then the story comes to a close starting in verse 40. It says this: "Then Jesus went back across the Jordan to the place where John the Baptist had been baptizing in the early days. There he stayed, and many people came to him. And they said, 'Though John never performed a sign, all that John said about this man was true.' And in that place, many believed in Jesus." Very cool. What a great way to close the story. The story starts with a cold winter day celebrating the festival of Hanukkah. They're in Solomon's colonnade with the glitz, with the glamour, with the beautiful architecture, with the beautiful adornment, the prestigious people. Yet there is a complete rejection of Jesus. But then the story ends with Jesus taking his ministry on the road, taking it to the towns where the people are not dressed to the T's, where the people do not have letters before and after their name signifying their ability or capabilities as scholars or students. And it's in that environment that those people believe in Jesus. I love that. We're going to talk about that a little bit more. There are two thoughts I want to send you away with today, two thoughts I want to send you home with. The first thought is this, and I have a whiteboard up here because I did not get my notes on in time, so I'm going to write them. So do not make fun of my handwriting. I've been told I make my D's the wrong way. I guess I start at the wrong side in my B's. I'm so nervous about this. This is what I'm... So here's point number one. Here's point number one. Jesus offers freedom from the frustrations of this life. Write that down. And I'm writing it down too. Jesus, don't laugh, offers freedom from, that's a rough F, from the, I'm going to go capital F, frustrations of this life. That's some good handwriting. Jesus offers freedom from the frustrations of this life. It's very important. It's a very important topic. I sort of skimmed over this originally in the text, but I want to spend more time on it, specifically what verse 27 and verse 28 says. Here's what it says. It says, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand." This is a very cool text here. What we see happening is Jesus essentially, again, identifying himself as the shepherd. Tim talked about this last week, how whether we like it or not, we're all being shepherded by something. Jesus, again, goes back to this concept of shepherds, and then, of course, sheep. Now, I know that Tim talked about it last week, and so I don't mean to belabor this point, but I want to talk about shepherding as well. But I want to talk about it from a different standpoint. I want to talk about it from the viewpoint of a literal shepherd. You see, in 1976, a guy by the name of Philip Keller wrote a book about Psalm 23, "The Lord is My Shepherd," from a literal shepherd's point of view. This is a man who lived on the hills, who took care of his own flock as a shepherd, and he wrote about Psalm 23 from the viewpoint of a shepherd. It's a very good book. I have it, and I was rereading it this week in preparation for this lesson. And in this book, he gathered many insights about sheep. He talked about the problem with sheep is their very nature. That's what he said. I love that. Basically, if you want to point out just the bummer with someone, you just go, it's just their overall presence. It's their overall nature. And he's like, the issue with sheep is just who they are. Like, it's just, that's the problem. He says sheep are neurotic, they're crazy, they don't make any sense, and they get scared at the smallest of things. He told a story in the book about how one time one of his friends came up to the mountains to visit him, and they had a little dog. I don't want to say rat dog, because that might be offensive. It was a little dog, and it was all fluffy. And the dog jumped out of the truck, and 200 sheep saw this little dog and took off running, like, danger. It's like, dude, it's a little dog. You could stomp on that thing. Not that you shouldn't, but sheep are neurotic. I'll go there. Here's what he says. Here's what he says. I love dogs. Here's what he says. He says, "Sheep refuse to lie down until they are clear of all fear. Because of their social behavior within a flock, sheep will not lie down unless they are free from friction with others of their kind. If tormented by flies or parasites, sheep will not lie down, and it's only when they are free of pests can they relax. Lastly, sheep will not lie down as long as they feel the need to find food. Sheep must be free from hunger." And then he says, "The natural state of a flock left unattended will always be discontent, agitated, in danger, and disturbed. I don't know about you, but when I swap out the word sheep from that paragraph and put my name, put your name, isn't that us? Isn't that us to a T? In fact, I did it. Here it is. Austin, Maddie, you can fact check. Austin won't experience rest until he has a plan for every potential roadblock in his life, whether it be emotional, financial, physical. Austin has to have everything figured out ahead of time. Fact check. Austin constantly struggles with the temptation to mock, belittle, and make fun of other people. She's a good wife. She's not saying anything right now. I'm just kidding. That's not in my natural state. Here's another one. Austin is constantly fighting the parasites of annoyance and gets frustrated at the smallest of things. That's true. I'm getting better, but there used to be a lot of like little things that would just like, people are, why? Like, why are you this way? And it would just, it just would blow my mind. Just the littlest of things, little tiny little parasites of annoyance. And they would just creep in and I would just rage at Maddie, not at her, but about life. And would just go like, what the heck? Here's another one. Austin is constantly hungry and needs his most basic needs met for any chance at comfort and happiness. Listen, I see what you guys do, especially you Weimer folk, when you lose power like every 45 minutes. You guys go on Facebook and it's like Red Dawn's about to happen, right? Like, what do we do? The power's out. Ah! You know, you're out like pumping water by hand, you know? It's like, what in the world? Smartwatch won't work. It's like the world is coming to an end. Isn't this us? Aren't we just like these crazy neurotic sheep? But the good news is that that's where the shepherd comes in, right? That's where the good shepherd comes in. That's when a good shepherd finds a way to lead us through this maze and nuance and craziness of life and allows us to lay down in green pastures and actually find rest. I guess what I'm getting at is that I believe there's a lot of people, specifically in the Christian community, that may feel like they are a loner, may feel like they are lost, may feel like they are cast out of society, may feel very isolated, may feel like you are constantly abandoned or left alone in life, and are someone who feels like they haven't experienced the feeling of real love in years. I think that's very real. But what I appreciate so much about what Jesus says here is that the good shepherd, in his kindness, offers a home with his flock. He offers a home in his family. He offers you a companion in the midst of that uncertainty, and he offers you salvation for all of eternity. I was thinking about this yesterday as I was kind of putting the finishing touches on this lesson, and there's an insight that maybe I'm reading too much into this, and you guys can be the judge of this, but I thought it was very fascinating, and I want to share it with you. What I think is very interesting about this story is that in John 10, I'm going to try to explain this as good as I can because I think it's interesting if it's explained the right way. In John 10, Jesus is the one encircled, right? Everybody's surrounding him. Jesus is in the middle of the circle. I think for you and me, if we were in that situation, we would feel like there was no way getting out. We would feel probably very afraid, overwhelmed emotionally, and just feeling like there's nothing that we can do in this situation. But here in John 10, it is very interesting. Jesus is in this very same situation, but we see that he finds a way out. He finds a way out. He makes it out. And as I was thinking about this and I was praying through this text, I was reminded of what Psalm 139:5 says. Psalm 139 says that I have encircled you. I have placed my hand upon you. And I was thinking to myself, how beautiful is that? That the good shepherd is standing encircled by his enemies. And he made it out. Then how much more then when we feel like we are encircled and hemmed in by everything in our life, we can have hope knowing that we can make it out because Jesus already made it out. I think that's incredible. We can have hope when we're encircled and hemmed in because the person that is leading us, the person that is guiding us, the voice we respond to is the person who's already won the war. And so we can make it through. And sometimes for us, I think that's the hope we need. That's the perspective we need to be able to traverse through that crowd. It may seem impossible, but the good shepherd's already made it through, and so you better believe he's done it once, he's gonna do it with you. That's what he says, Psalm 139:5. So that's number one. Jesus offers freedom from the frustrations of life. And then number two, and this is very important, the story of Jesus, you should be writing this down like we're in class, of Jesus, is for all people. The story of Jesus is for all people. I love this. I referenced this a little bit towards the end of when I was kind of describing the story. But notice how when Jesus escapes the masses, once he gets out of the circle of doom, he finds a way into the countryside. And he finds a way away from the temple elites, and he finds his way into the world of the ordinaries. Here's what it says in verse 40. Then Jesus went back across the Jordan to the place where John had been baptizing in the early days. There he stayed, and many people came to him, and they said, though John never performed a sign, all that God sent about this man was true. And in that place, many believed in Jesus. I love that. What's so encouraging to me about the last part of verse 10 is that Jesus' ministry was not isolated to beautiful places and beautiful people. His ministry was not isolated to the grand cathedrals and the vast hallways. No, the ministry of Jesus really caught fire when he ventured into the areas of the ordinary, the fishermen, the farmers, the women, the children. What I want us to see here is that the story of Jesus, regardless of who you are, what you've accomplished, or what you've inherited, or anything about you, the story of Jesus is for you. It's for those in the temple, and it's for those in the farmhouse. It's for everyone. It's for everyone. And your lack of giftings or your doubt that you may have does not disqualify you from using God, from God using you in miraculous ways. I want to tell you guys a story to close our time today. This story takes place in 1782. It's in England. It's about a guy by the name of Robert Morrison. Robert Morrison was not spectacular on the surface. He did not have letters after his name. He was not somebody that we would deem as an elitist by any means. He was one of eight kids. He was the youngest of the eight. He went to a normal school. He would go to school all morning, and then he would come home and he would work with his dad in his boot shop. He would make boots for people. And he would do this all his life, pretty much, until he graduated from primary school, from high school. He was brought up in a Christian household. His mother died when he was a young child, and so he was brought up by his father. But his dad made an effort to make sure that on Sundays, they were always in church and learning about Jesus. And when they weren't there, they were at school or making boots. Well, in 1804, Robert Morrison decided that he wanted to be a missionary. He felt the call to be a missionary. And he felt that God was calling him to an area of the world that was kind of peculiar. He wanted to go to China. He wanted to go to China. Now, similar to today, China was not an area that was wide open for outsiders to come into. It was actually very difficult and very dangerous for Robert Morrison to even want to go into China to be a missionary. Eventually, he found his way there. He had to get on a boat, sail around, a huge journey there. He had to basically find and get his way into the country in very covert ways. But when Morrison got to China, he began to minister to the people, and he realized something very sad about the Chinese people, and that is this. They didn't have a Bible. The Bible was not translated into Chinese. And so for the next 27 years, that's how long he spent in China, he spent his life translating the Bible from Greek, Aramaic, and Hebrew into Chinese. 27 years. Faithful minister. Teaching regularly. At the end of his life, 27 years, Morrison spent faithfully ministering to China. Take a guess how many people through his ministry met Jesus in China. 27 years. How about 100? About 300? 5,000? What about 50,000? All wrong. What about 10? 10,000? No. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 people. That's it. I don't know about you, but it's kind of a letdown, right? It's like the ROI is not really there. 10 people, 27 years? That's not even one per year. I'm like, dude, like, I don't know. Like, maybe my funding might come to an end after that. Like, but the story doesn't end there. The second convert that Morrison had in China many years in was a local Chinese man named Liang Fa. And this man, when he got saved, dedicated his life to telling other people about Jesus. And through the ministry of Fa, literally thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of Chinese people met Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Now, I want to tell you why I shared this story with you. I shared this story with you to remind you of something very important, and that is this. It does not matter where you come from or the giftings you think you don't have, God can use you in miraculous ways. We may or may not see the fruit of what God is doing in our life, but rest assured, God is doing something. God is doing something. Some of us may be the Robert Morrisons. Some of us may be building a foundation that is built on for many years to come. Some of us may not see the fruit of our labor in this life, but we have to trust that God is doing something special. That God is building something beautiful. And it doesn't matter where you come from, the family you originate from, or the abilities you think you do or don't have, God can do something through you. And so could we all bow our heads real quick as I call the band back up? I want to pray for us. I want to pray for two things in particular. These are the two prayers of today. First, I want to pray over the people in this room who are lost, who are frustrated, who are annoyed and who are anxious about life. The prayer request for us today is that we would experience the same victory that Jesus had in John chapter 10, and that we would realize that even when we feel surrounded by everything in our life, we would see that there is a way through. But that way through is only possible when the Good Shepherd is the one leading us. I want to pray that we would rely on the Good Shepherd to get us through those difficult areas of our life. And then the second group of people I want to pray for are the people who are struggling with an identity crisis, struggling with the inability and the feeling of insufficiency to never be used by God for anything of eternal significance. My prayer for us would be that you would realize there are no loose ends or meaningless existences as a member of God's family. And that every conversation we have, every interaction we have, and every time we share the story of Jesus with someone, you could be the very thing that God uses to reach thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of people. And you may never see the fruit of that, but rest assured, God is using you. God is using you. And so I want to pray for us. Father, I pray for this first group of people, Lord, the frustrated, the annoyed, the anxious, the bitter, perhaps. God, help us realize that when we are surrounded by all of these difficult things, Lord, you have made a path and you have made a way through. Father, help us cling to the Good Shepherd. Thank you, Lord, that we hear your voice. Thank you, Lord, that you call our name. Thank you that you know our name. Father, I lift up the second group of people, Lord, with people who may be dealing with a sense of insufficiency or inadequacy, the people who have been working and striving for godliness all their life, but just haven't seen the fruit that they would have expected over their entire time working in the job or ministering to their family. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would comfort them and you would show them that the work they are doing, the conversations they are having, the relationships they are building are not in vain, and that you work in mysterious ways, Lord. Father, I thank you for our church, and I thank you for John chapter 10. And I pray, Lord, that through this entire next couple weeks as we jump into cross-culture, Lord, we would be firmly tethered to the Good Shepherd, and that you would lead us through all of these uncomfortable and charged conversations, Lord, with grace, mercy, kindness, love, and truth. We love you so much, Jesus, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.